Good afternoon and eet smakelijk. We have some English guests or English-speaking guests, and this morning I read some tweets that I was going to give this lecture all in English. So I was thinking, okay, do I need to change to English or not? This is about a Dutch popular science magazine, but it can be done in English or in Dutch, so I don't mind. I will need to go back and forth a bit towards my laptop to explain to you about the wonderful world of Quest, one of the largest magazines in the country. What I'm going to do is explain to you how we make the magazine, which choices we make, why we make these choices, and how we come to our subjects, and why we are a success, and what are our plans for the future, which is for magazines at the moment not so clear. So that will be what you will be expecting for the next half hour. The last 10 minutes or 5 minutes, I want to talk to you and maybe present to you an idea I have where I need your talent. So stay focused, hopefully, and wait for the end. This is like a cliffhanger. At the end, I need you. But first, this is something you usually end with. I always start with this because I want to know, what is it that you want to know? So are there questions at this time that you would like me to answer? Then I will make sure that I involve them in my presentation. Anybody? Any questions? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Any more? No? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Good, good. Okay? Okay. These questions will be answered in the next half hour. This is what we are, for those that don't know, and not everybody knows. In Dutch, it would say we are the second magazine after Linda. Anybody in Holland knows Linda, but most people, of course, also know Quest, but they don't know how big we are. Linda has a circulation of over 200,000. Quest has a circulation of 160,000 sold circulation, which is large. If you compare it, for instance, in the popular science angle towards of to Kijk or Know-How, Kijk is, and Know-How are both around 30,000. So we are really large. We have 75,000 subscribers alone. Their average age is 32. So the 32 means the average age of the Quest reader. Lots of people still think Quest is a magazine for 13 to 19-year-olds. Kijk used to be that magazine, but that was like 20 years ago. This time, these kind of magazines like Quest are aiming at a 32 average age, somewhere between, say, 12 and 82, I think. The split between men and women is 55-45. So if you compare that to Linda, Linda will be like 95-5, female-male. We are 55-45. And the nice thing about this is that, to look at it from a commercial point of view, Quest was launched 11 years ago as a magazine which would be a product in the men's market. And that was only thought of because of the advertisers. Advertisers in magazines choose their platforms, and there are lots of magazines, of course, in the female sector. So if you want to launch a magazine there, you have to compete Linda, Vogue, Glamour, whatever. And in the male sector, it's maybe a little bit easier. The competition is Panorama, New Revue, Football International, whatever. And on the other hand, it never worked. Quest is not an advertising medium, and I like it. We don't have too much advertising. Our readers don't like it at all. They expect some advertising because they know otherwise their magazine would be even more expensive. But on the other hand, I'm glad we don't have too much advertising because it could also put you in a situation where you have to keep in mind that this advertiser is there and he pays you that much and you have to think of that. We don't have to think of that at all. Even if it was so, we wouldn't, by the way. This is what we do this year. We make 24 magazines. All sorts of these one, this is the, I'll put them here and anybody can take them. This is the monthly, this comes out 12 times a year. This is one of the examples of the special magazines. These we make 4 times a year. We also make one called Quest Psychology, couldn't find it this morning. Also 4 times a year. These we make once a year. Especially the left one is a nice one because this is the result of 2,500 questions we get each year from our readers. We pick out the 101 most special, or the ones that we like, or the ones that a jury likes. And then a jury decides which one is the winning question. For instance, this year, or last year, the winning question was, where on earth is the chance, the smallest, that you would be victim of a natural disaster? And that would be Qatar, by the way. The chance that you would be victim of a natural disaster, the highest, is somewhere in Oceania, where actually 2 or 3 months ago, they again, all sorts of islands were washed completely away, almost completely away by water. And the problem with those situations or those countries is that they get washed over by water and they don't come back and then make sure that it doesn't happen again. It happens again and again and again because they keep coming back to fish and harvest or whatever, but they keep forgetting that, or they don't have the resources to make sure that they can stop the water from flowing over. Last year, the year before, I mean, the winning question was, how much taxes do I pay in a year? Or in my lifetime, I mean. That was one that was completely, you know, motivated by the whole economic situation, which was a great question. By the way, so if you have a standard media, or no, it's not, committed, average income, you pay 1.5 million in taxes in your lifetime. So keep studying, keep working hard. By the way, half of it is your own pension. This one we will make for the first time this year. It's fun. It will be fun for the front row in the car, but also for the back row. You know, we have lots of fans in the younger age groups. We have lots of families that read Quest, and this is the first time we'll make a magazine for parents, but also for their children, say, age 10 and over. This is how many people we have. By the way, these are more magazines we make. We have a large staff, if you compare it, for instance, to Linda's staff. Linda has like 5 to 6 people, I think, and they have a large group of freelance around them, and they do whatever they do. We've decided at the beginning, let's build a good staff and a strong staff, and let's not work with too many freelance, as long as we can pay for them. And this is how it's more or less split out. The interns are not only, well, the, most of them are students, that's when they can become an intern anyway, but they're not only writers, they're also for images, they're also for interaction design, they are there for online, different marketing, lots of interns also. So we have more or less 5 interns all of the time. What I've found for me, I've worked for, I think, 30 years and 20 years more or less in magazines and 10 years in television, television development. This staff, beeldredacteur, as we say in Dutch, I've never worked with them before. Usually designers, vormgevers, would come with pictures themselves and then, you know, design the pages. In this case, Quest, being a magazine with so many images, so many different images, decided, okay, we need image editors as well. So once we decide, okay, this will be the story, and I will tell you later how we make a story. Once we've decided this, a writer will start writing, and the picture editor will start looking for pictures, and not only pictures that complement the stuff that's been written, but also pictures that tell their own story. And that's a big difference between how most magazines are made, where the basis is like an article, and they put some pictures with it, like an interview or whatever. We look for pictures that tell a different story, the one that isn't really told in the text, because it's already there. So let's paint another story in the pictures. First time I work with them, at the moment, they are not only involved with the printing productions we do, but also online, social media, etc. So they're quite important and are never realized before. Weetjes, we would say in Dutch. Weetjes. Facts of knowledge. Sounds a little bit more sincere, I think. Weetjes. I think it's at least 200 facts of knowledge. One article of, say, 6 pages, it could be a small piece of 80 words, but it could be an article of 6 pages, would could easily contain 30, maybe 40, depending on what the angle is, what the story is, what we are writing. In the end, all those facts of knowledge, somewhere hidden or built into a story, is the I think one of the most important factors of Quest. Every piece you read, you always find something which gives you more information or maybe a little bit more knowledge. And that is, I think, what a magazine at this stage of the competition, where it's so hard to compete with Facebook, with television, with all other sorts of media that there are, a magazine should really, you know, make a difference from what you already read on the internet, etc. I think most of the stuff that you read in Quest, you can also find online. The way we present it to you makes it a difference, makes it easier, makes it braintainment, makes it nice to know, and maybe sometimes even a little bit neat to know. We say plumber to professor. That is something that has been developed at the beginning, where they say, okay, you should have like a target reader. This target reader can be a plumber, but the target reader can also be a professor. And somewhere in between, we should have enough information. So the plumber can also read magazines, our magazine, but the professor should also, you know, if he has time, read the magazine. And somewhere in between, I think the average educational level of our reader will be just above average, I think. Plumber to professor, we never use it anymore. The guy, they even gave the guy a name called Frans. Didn't like it, so we don't use that. We have 5 key themes, like what we call pillars. Those are the themes that are always in the magazine. It's not always the same amount, but there's always something about science, technology, psychology, history, etc. We even make specials of history and psychology. It's not always the same, but if you have a magazine that is too much about science and technology, and you forget like biology or psychology, readers will not recognize their magazine. And the key ingredient of making a magazine is always your reader is expecting something, deliver that to your reader, and then surprise him or her. That is the key element of making a magazine, is making sure that you don't go, you know, from like black to white to purple and nothing in between. You always have to manage expectations, and expectations need to be solid, and of course they must trust you and like you, but then be somewhere in between that expectation, you have to make sure that you surprise them, because they want to be surprised every time, you know, want to be more or less confirmed about the money that they spent on you. So we use these 5 pillars as the basis of Quest. And of course, there's lots of other side steps, but these ones are always there. Okay, how do we create an article? We don't follow the news. We don't at all. We don't follow the news because we go to print, and then the magazine comes out like 3 to 4 weeks later. So we can't follow the news, because we are news would always, you know, be ahead of us, and we would always come late. So we said no news. We just more or less make our own news. And it's not news like, okay, opening of the newspapers or whatever, but it's that what we find interesting, what makes us curious, what we find something that we want to write about, because it concerns ourselves or something else, our own situation, whatever. It's more or less our own feelings and the mix that we make of what we like that makes us make the magazine. It doesn't involve news. So it's not about press releases or anything. We have all sorts of sources. Press releases is one. It doesn't mean that a press release sent to us will be, you know, one-on-one in the magazine. It would always be something that starts us, that inspires us to look for an angle towards an article. Articles can also be whatever is in the newspaper, whatever is in another magazine that we see or read. We hear about stuff. I think reader questions, last one, is the most important one. I think one third of the magazine, at least, contains answers to questions that have been put to us by readers. So readers feel really involved with the magazine. This is also another big key element of the importance of making a magazine, that your readers feel connected to you. They feel involved. So make sure that they see something of their own thoughts back in the magazine without them, you know, being the ones that write the article. We are the ones that write the article, but we get inspired by our readers. Like this weekend, I have two very small children. My wife's on Ibiza, and I was taking care of the children. My youngest son, he's 2, and he's puberty. Peuter puberty, we would say. And that means that he gets up at around 2 o'clock, and he's decided he doesn't want to go to sleep again. So I have to make sure that he does, because I have to sleep as well. By the end, he's sleeping, and I'm awake in my bed, and I hear the church bells ringing all the time. And I'm thinking, why the hell? I mean, we all have clocks. We all have alarms. We don't need churches to ring anymore, and especially not at 2 o'clock in the night. So I sent this at 2:30, I sent an email to my colleague who does the question and answer section in the magazine. Why is this? And this morning she sent back to me. I said, yeah, I was wondering the same. I like it, but I was wondering the same. I hated it because I couldn't sleep, of course, with the bells ringing all the time. This is like a question. I mean, this would be probably, this question we'll have to go back to into history, why we have the churches, when the churches were, you know, and villages were built around churches, and what is the function of the bells? Okay. It could be a nice article. So that's something about Engel. Engel can also be the same editor, by the way. She woke up, got out of house, and noticed the whole street was broken up. And she reminded, oh, that's right, they were going to do something about the sewage, the Riol. And she came at the office and said, there's something about sewage. And somebody said, okay, how can they repair sewages in Holland? It's not like where you see in films where they drive minis into sewages, you know, this film, Italian Job or something, and they drive minis into sewages. I mean, in Holland, they're like this big, more or less, or maybe even smaller. How does that work? We found out it's a lot of robotics and science, and there's lasers, and there's cameras, and there's all sorts of technical stuff. So all of a sudden, this became an article of 5 pages about great techniques and Dutch inventions even. Could also have been a history story where it would be, since when do we have this stuff? Why are they there? And what does it mean for society, etc.? So, and it could also be, of course, a biology where what comes in, what goes out, etc. Poop's quite an interesting subject for Quest, one way or another, until I said, now enough poop. Substantiate scientifically. I changed that from wetenschappelijk onderbouwing. What's important for Quest, and I think which makes also the final part of what makes Quest trustworthy, is that we always look for scientifically substantiated, to make sure that the onderbouwing, that we find research that has been done to clarify a situation. We don't look at research as, okay, this doctor says this and this professor says does. No. We look at an angle, say, okay, how will we approach this subject? Then we see what kind of research has been done and what can we use of this. This is the time when scientists and researchers and other people in science are being contacted by us. We find them by looking up at the internet, by looking into libraries, by speaking to people, by having a Rolodex with names, having knowing somebody who knows somebody, contacting NWO. That's also an important source for us. Also, a client even. We make this magazine every year for NWO, which is all about the state of science in the country, and also about the Spinoza Awards. So we always look for science. We don't look at the science and the research itself and then look for angles towards the research, etc. We see what we can use. We make sure that it's trustworthy. But, and that's something that always happens with us, we use the science and the research when we need it for our story as a underlayer. And it's not about the research itself, why the research was done, what the results of the research is. So it's only the way we use it to make it more trustworthy, to explain stuff, and to uphold our, our level of professionalism and the trustworthiness of our magazine towards our readers. So that's the popular science part, I think. The science part would be taking a research, explaining it, maybe looking at it from different angles, and then writing an article. What we say is, okay, we want to write this article, this is the angle, it's about technology. Then we look at, okay, what does it mean for people, what does it mean for the society, whatever. Then we look at what kind of research is done, we look at one, two, three angles from research, use that in the article, and then write the article. But it started with, why, how do we repair our sewage, for instance, sewage. And it's not about research or some scientific research has been done about changing whatever health in communities. It's our angle, and we see what we can use of the research that has been done. As any magazine, you have to sell. You make sure that your subscriptions rates are enough, that you sell enough copies through newsstand to make sure that the circulation keeps where it should be, and to maintain a profitable organization. We are a commercial product. We use social media a lot. We find that social media, especially with our facts of knowledge, our weetjes, is a great way to present weetjes. For instance, we had one fact of knowledge which said, from a bigger article in Quest Psychology, the eldest one in a family is usually the smartest. And if it just says, if you have this picture of a baby and it just says the eldest one is usually the smartest, and you put that out on Facebook and Twitter, viral. 3.5 million people in Holland on Facebook saw this picture and what it said. But more importantly, 80,000 people clicked on the link towards Quest Psychology. And that was what we aimed to do and what we are trying to make better and better all the time. It's great that your knowledge is shared. It's great that people listen to me on the radio or wherever, but that doesn't make them buy Quest or think of, maybe think a little bit of Quest, when they are in their own environment, looking at Facebook, and somebody shares something from Quest and they click on a link. All of a sudden, they are more interested in Quest. And what we are working on now is making sure that once they are there, that they find more of their liking, etc., to make sure that they get more involved with Quest and maybe even buy Quest every now and then. And we need this. In the last 1.5 years, we lost 80,000 subscribers. We got 75,000 back, but we lost 80,000. 80. And that happens because the loyalty of subscribers, as it used to be, in the old days, you used to be member of a magazine. You would call yourself member of a magazine. Nowadays, you don't feel like a membership. You don't feel too much loyalty. It's the same loyalty you have for your Essent or Eneco or your energy company. It's the same loyalty you have for your phone subscription or your mobile, or maybe even newspapers nowadays. So we have to look for other ways to make sure that subscribers stay, and that they even make sure that they stay longer. PR and radio, television, it helps, it works, it makes sure. This morning I got a call because I was on RTL Boulevard. You know, RTL Boulevard. This morning I got a call. I was there 2 weeks ago about an issue and something with celebrities in Holland and faces and facial recognitions, etc. And they liked it so much that they want me there every week. Okay, it's good. Quest every week in RTL Boulevard. I like it. And as long as I can stay myself, can be who I am, and make sure that I represent Quest, it can help. This is the way our circulation is going. It used to be, 2007 was the high point, where most magazines were more successful, of course. It was over 200,000. At the moment, it's 160. So it's going down. It will never go up again, I'm sure. It will remain for a long time. Magazines will be there for a very long time, I think. Some people say in 10 years' time, magazines are gone. I don't believe it. They'll be there for a long time, but they will lose circulation more and more. You know, who knows what is our biggest enemy? Internet? Anybody else? Uh-huh. Yeah, it does. One Quest reaches 1.1 million people. Newspapers? Facebook. Facebook is our biggest enemy. And that is only because Facebook takes so much time for people to look at stuff, to share stuff, to, you know, be among their friends, talk to the friends, whatever, whatever, that the time they used to spend reading magazines is now put into social media, say Facebook for the most of the time. Which means that once, especially when you have subscriptions and your pile gets higher and higher and higher of unread magazines because you are so busy at Facebook, etc. And then you are confronted with a new, you know, okay, we want you to renew your subscription. You get a letter from me saying, okay, back and then pay 60 euros. And all of a sudden you think, 60 euros, and I haven't read, you know, half of this pile. And then that is the time when most people say, okay, let's stop. What I find, of course, is that then people start buying magazines in the newsstand, so I don't mind. But Facebook is a big, big factor in this case. I think the most for magazines and the way people read magazines as, you know, relaxation, maybe some information. It's more or less the same as a lot of people use Facebook and Twitter, mostly Facebook. So we have to find new ways to make money. Those specials I showed you are a nice way to make money because it's a nice way to write about, say, for instance, the fire department. They ordered like 150,000 of these. The Ministry of Defense and all about working in either the Army or the Navy or whatever. Digital, we find that with a circulation of 160, we sell, how many copies do you think we sell on, say, the tablets? So that's a magazine, but then a digital, it's just a PDF, that's all. It doesn't move or anything. How many copies? If we sell 160,000 each month through subscriptions and newsstand, how many copies do we sell in the iPad store and the Google newsstand? Anybody? 5,000? 30,600. We are a magazine. You want to hold it. You know, it comes through your door. It drops on the floor. You take it with you to the couch. You take it with you in the toilet. You have it next to your bed. That's where you read magazines, especially monthly magazines that have no, you know, newsy content. So. You can pick it up anytime, you can leave it, you can pick it up again. It doesn't, you know, if you pick it up 3 months later, it still feels like it's been there for just a day or something. That really helps us and other monthly magazines. News, weekly and daily magazines, like newspapers, they really benefit from the whole development on tablets, etc. But our monthly magazines still, you know, people want to hold it, smell it even. Blendl, on the other hand, you know, all know Blendl? Blendl is a newsstand where you buy not just the magazine, you buy the article in the magazine. You can choose, like, you pay 50 cents for an article in Vrij Nederland, and 80 cents for an article in Quest, and then 30 cents for an article in Quote or Elle or whatever. So It's a completely digital newsstand where you can buy just the article and not the whole magazine. You can also buy the whole magazine, but most people just buy one article. We have now the article that has sold most in the history of Blendl, which is only 1 year, by the way. But our story about spelt brood and volkoren, whole wheat, 5 pages for 50 cents, has been sold 8,000 times, which is a lot in Blendl. In 1 year, we've earned around 15,000 euros in Blendl. It's time for me to start talking to freelancers that have written these articles and, you know, also have to get something back from that. Questies Nederlands, very shortly, because it's a whole presentation in itself, but we found a way to get people online and be involved with Quest in a great new way instead of, you know, copying what we do in print on online. What we said is, okay, let's say online you can also only do tests. So what we do now is you can test yourself, your knowledge, or you can be part of a scientific research even. We have around 130 tests, 40 of them are scientific researches, like how autistic are you? What is your opinion about Zwarte Piet, for instance? Last year we had an research with the Vrije Universiteit, the VU in Amsterdam. Somebody wanted to know something about Zwarte Piet, so we had some questions about that. He got all the data. How autistic are you is done with the UvA, University of Amsterdam. 75,000 people have done that test. Usually, these researchers would have newly, say 10 people from the first year in psychology, would have them do the tests. Now they've put their test out through us. 75,000 people have done that test. That gives them so much data to work with to start maybe a different angle on the research. Of course, it's not the complete research, but it's a great extra for the research. What we do now is we put tests out for stories that we want to write 4 months later. So we have a test which leads to a story, which leads to PR, which leads to more people doing the test, and maybe even another test. So it's a great combination of stuff, and we are now building a completely new website for this because it's so successful. Reuse of content is another new way. All people talk about it. Most people don't have the content. We do. We have like 8,500 questions and answers only. If I get a call from, say, Slam FM, you know Slam FM? All of a sudden, Slam FM sounds very easy to pronounce in when you're talking English. Slam FM had me on the radio Tuesday evenings at 8:30 for all their listeners who were studying for their school exams. And I had like weetjes, even you know weetjes at the moment, about exams, how to learn, what not to do, you know, all sorts of stuff. Can you grow more brain and how do you do that and stuff like that, you know, funny stuff, but also scientific because there was always research underneath. And Quest Junior, finally, Quest Junior will be launched next year. Not this year. I wanted it this year, but it's not enough time. Quest Junior will be launched next year. It will be a magazine, and I love it now already for curious kids from, say, 8 to 14. Target group will be Bovenbouw, say 11, 12-year-olds, primary school, at the end of primary school. Curious kids, but also, very important, curious teachers, because there, I find, is a very important task for us, I think, to stimulate teachers to, you know, step out of their comfort zones maybe a little and then start, you know, being more interested in especially the science and technology subjects that are very important for children. And we find we are now developing ways to make sure that teachers are involved and parents with science and technology. So, yes, exactly on time. I didn't even plan it. I have two plans. And I would like you to think about it. One is, have you heard of the National Science Agenda? The Nationale Wetenschapsagenda, NWA. The National Science Agenda is at the moment being, they've got 12,000 questions. They are trying to get that back to 10 questions. 10 questions that will be put on an agenda, because this is what our society, our researchers, our scientists and our bedrijfsleven, commercial life, finds important. This science agenda will be presented somewhere at the end of November in a weekend which starts with a De Wereld Draait Door broadcast with Robert Dijkgraaf, who will give another college lecture. Then there are 2 days of science festival, and which will end with another De Wereld Draait Door episode where the agenda will be presented. We, together with NWA, Nationale Wetenschapsagenda, will be hosting the festival, which is a great task for us, which is great to do. We were planning this anyway somewhere in October, and then all of a sudden we heard from them, and then they said, okay, De Wereld Draait Door doesn't mind, which is very important, and now we are also involved with the festival. We have this idea of, you know, experiencing festival, looking at stuff, being part of stuff, being part of some sort of research while you are there, or quantified or whatever, quest test even, all sorts of ideas. And I would like you to think about what you could contribute. Maybe some research you are doing. You know, these solar challenges that are always there, where TU Delft is also involved. Maybe there are completely different science researches we don't know about, stuff that you can test there. You have like 5,000 to 10,000 people that are there on a Saturday and a Sunday. You can use them any way you like, because they are there for science. They want to experience this. If you have a science cooking class, be our guest. You know, contact me first, but come. I would like it to be a festival, and I'll have a meeting this afternoon even about it. I would like it to be a festival where, you know, you can be part of stuff, you can watch stuff, you can learn from stuff. There will be lectures, of course. There will be meets and greets and whatever, but it should be, you know, science being there without borders, and just be part of it and experience it. Bring your children if you have them, bring your parents, why not, if you have them, and make sure that you experience what science can do and how important it can be, and maybe get some more insights into science. Bring your friends and say to them, this is what I do every day. The Startup Club is the other idea. We are from a publishing tradition which has a lot of heritage. It used to be great to have a lot of heritage. You know, we have brands like National Geographic, and Folk, and Glamour, and Yum, and Quest. Great brands and great heritage, and, you know, the magazines, and people more or less, you know, they grew up with magazines, etc. But in this digital age and all the possibilities that are there, this heritage can also, a legacy, can also be like a, you know, something that it's in your way, because it doesn't give you the freedom, because you're so, you know, used to thinking from brands and circulations and readers and target groups, etc., that it's hard to make the step into towards, you know, the future, and think of you know, in a startup kind of way, if we try this, and if this doesn't work, let's try that, and, you know, look at it from a different, and let's get that, and this kind of thinking I would like to integrate into Quest with a group of young students, not young people for me, young people, who would be part of a, say, six, seven group of all sorts of backgrounds in studies. Get your product, say for instance this, and have 2 days and just think of something else. What can we do with this? What can we do from this? What can become of this? What could be digital, could be an event, could be, you know, a whole new learning experience, a course, a computer game. Could be anything. I would love it for students with different backgrounds, smart heads, smart minds, open minds, no heritage. Probably most of them won't read magazines, and maybe they have in their past, in their youth, but they won't, I don't think, many of them will read magazines at the moment, and it's not about magazines. We know most of the stuff we do about magazines, and fortunately we are still a little bit successful with it. But we also find that, you know, success is getting smaller every time. So what can we do that doesn't exist, that can be new, that can change stuff? And I would like for a group of students to start, even this summer, getting together and like a more or less working in a hackathon kind of atmosphere, where you get a assignment or you get a product, no assignment, just this is the product, be our guest, and in the next 36 hours we would like you to come up with a new idea. It doesn't have, you maybe even a prototype, why not? Doesn't have to be a prototype, doesn't have to be an app all the time, can be anything. But I would like for new talents to get together and teach us stuff. We don't know everything. We know about the heritage, we know about the brand, we know how to make magazines. We even know how to make apps that don't sell. But what we don't know is how you look at the future. So if you have ideas, if you have backgrounds, it can be psychology, it can be informatic engineering, it could be, you know, anything, reach out to me through my email, please, and present yourself. Be part of it. You can, of course, there's money. You can earn money with it. You get a salary. I would like it I would really like it to be a group of 6-7 people that will stay together, so that I can call on them every now and then, like 5 to 6 times a year for 2 days. You'll get a salary. You earn some money. You'll be part of maybe something huge. Maybe something small, maybe something that helps you along in your career and in your studies and what you develop. You can become friends with, you know, people from completely different backgrounds, completely different interests, but all looking at the future and, you know, using your ideas in, and translating them in a very short period under guidance by people that know how to, you know, get the best out of a short period. You learn from it, but you can also you know, use it maybe in your own careers. I'm sorry, it's about young people in this case. but I would love it for people to come. I've told this, I said this last Thursday in Leiden. Today I said it in Delft. I started my journalistic career in Delft as part of the Delftse Courant, which is completely gone, as far as I know. Then I went to study in Leiden. First I went to study in Leiden, then I went to Delft, so I've more or less completed this route in my life. And now I'm in Amsterdam again, making questions, thinking all these big ideas, which hopefully will come true, because I believe in what we do, I believe in the power of Quest, but I also know that we can go further and we need help of people like you. So tell your friends, or don't tell your friends if you have a great idea, then tell me. And maybe I'll speak to you again. Thank you very much.